Today's session is about media management and seeing this media as a market. To know the media, this is a brief introduction for the next unit, which deals with the media economics. So today what we are going to see is media selection, planning and scheduling. So this is what the media market, to have a brief idea. So after completion of this session, you should be able to understand the concept of media planning and the role of media in overall marketing and advertising plan. And also to discuss the consideration relevant to the media selection. So describing the dominant factors in media scheduling. So today's class will have a brief idea about media selection, media planning and media scheduling. So media management involves one of the most crucial dimensions for an advertiser in its objectives to reach effectively the target markets. So the decisions assume further is the critical importance, the wide availability of media vehicles and the change in the reading and the viewing usage patterns in buying public. For instance, markets have been flooded with a large assortment of print media in recent times, and also as well as the television and also the new media. Similarly, a vast spectrum of programs also available on television as a capture for an alternative home audience. So it has to be done outside. So unfamiliar media are now in style. So many media were in the vogue and style. So these examples include match boxes carrying product advertisements, or the food masala mix, food mixes carrying the marketing messages of good and social causes. For example, here there is on media Shakti Masala, it's a food mix product, so which carries the good and social causes. Obviously the advertiser has to seek answers to the following questions. Obviously, so how to spend the defined funds allocated to advertising and promotional activities? How to match the media audience with the market audience for the product or service? How to benefit from seasonal variations mostly prevalent in sales of all goods and services? How to view media with the overall marketing effort? So these are the basic questions where the advertisers want seeks to answer for the following questions. How to spend the funds and how to match the media audience with the market audience for any product or service, and on how to benefit from seasonal variations mostly prevalent in sales of all goods and service, and how to view this media with the overall marketing effort. So this module will attempt some answers for these questions. So media as a term can be defined both from the users and suppliers perspective. Media as a term can be defined both from the users and the suppliers perspective. To the users of media, that is advertisers and audiences. From users perspective, it is advertisers and audiences. It is the mix of mediums that carry the advertiser's message and constitute as the vast link between the company and the that manufactures and serves the product and the customer who buy or might wish to buying it. So this is what the perspective of an user. So for the perspective of the user is advertiser's message constitute and vast link between the company that manufactures and serves the product and the customer who buy or might wish to buying it. So it's like a marketing communication aimed at wider audiences located at different places. So media suppliers, if you see the term of media from the media suppliers perspective, include the institutions that offer media. To them, it's a mix of service organizations which aim to fulfill the needs of listeners, viewers and readers for information and entertainment. Are you clear with the two perspective of media, one from the user's point of view and the user's perspective, and the other, the in other hand, it's a media supplier's perspective. In the user's perspective, the advertiser's message is the vast link between the company that manufactures the goods or products with the customer who buy or wish to buy. And from the media supplier's perspective, the media is termed to be a mix of service organizations which aim to fulfill their needs of listeners, their needs for the listeners, viewers and readers for information and entertainment. You see, the important point to be noted is media are not primarily and purely for carrying the marketing messages. They render a far more meaningful and comprehensive set of beneficial services in which besides entertainment and information, marketing messages are carried to the audience. So that is the main important thing to be noted is media is not primarily for carrying the marketing messages. Besides entertainment and information, marketing messages are carried to the audience. Naturally, therefore, each medium will do its best for making it more effective, attractive, effective and closer to its audience. These media themselves have to market to the media users. So the different types of media, advertisers virtually face ocean full of media choices, though many of them may be summarily rejected as being irrelevant, either the product type or customer consumer types. So what are the different types of media? All the following are the different types of media where an advertiser or the manufacturer of goods or products can use to market their product. Directory media, we will see the definition later. Of each and every media type. Just here I listed out some of the media types. Directory media, direct mail media, radio advertising, point of purchase media, outdoor media, newspaper, media magazine, transit media, screen media, television media, specialty media. So these are the different types of media outlets available for an advertisers to carry their message. So now we will get into the process of media planning. So like any other planning, media planning is done by specialists who have the necessary amount of training and experiences. Normally, media planning answers the following questions: when, which, how much, the timing of the ad publication, the selection of the media, how the coordination in media planning, how much the budgeting of the ad resources. So thus, media planning is a process of designing a course of action that shows how advertising time and space will be used to contribute to the achievement of marketing objective. In this process, media planner takes into consideration factors like media strategy, tactics, different various media planning models, and the effect of advertising along with procedures for buying media. So media plan is the end product of media planning, and it's similar to a blueprint of advertising programs of a company. To obtain this blueprint, the company must become involved in many activities that are related to the firm's marketing situation. So here the company has to work with the marketing situations of the manufacturer's activity. Scope of a media plan, so media planning activities, it's a process. Three things has to be done: the situation analysis, marketing strategy plans, and creative strategy plan. So the purpose of the situation analysis is to understand the marketing problem. So an analysis made of a company and its competitors, size and share of total market, sales history, costs and profits, distribution practice, methods of selling, use of advertising. So the situation analysis will analyze the first preliminary stage of analysis, which analyze the parts. So the marketing strategy plans. The purpose of the marketing strategy plan is to plan activities which will solve one or more of their marketing problems. Their marketing objectives, product and selling spending strategy, distribution strategy, which element the elements of marketing mix are used and identify the best marketing segments. So the creative strategy plan, as we said, media planning is a process. These are the process which involve creative strategy plan. In this stage, you have to plan what to communicate through advertisements, including the determination of how product can meet the consumer needs, how product will be positioned to advertisements, copy, creative field, creative requirements, specific objectives of each advertisements, and number and size of advertisements. So with this, all this, considering all these factors are important and doing base research, then taking into account of all these points, we have to set our media objectives. Before setting our media objectives, the situation analysis, marketing strategy plans, and creative strategy plans has to be considered, and it has to be worked out, and to set our media objective. So the media objectives purpose is to translate marketing objectives and strategies into goal that media can accomplish. Then after setting up the media objective, you have to translate marketing objectives, translate the marketing objectives and the goal media can accomplish, so to determine the media strategy. So as a media setting, before setting up the media objective, the media plan, the situation analysis, the creative strategy, the marketing strategy, and the situation analysis plan. So this will help you to, this groundwork will of the product and from the marketer will help you to come out with a good media plan. At each stage of this planning process, you would recognize the importance of facts and figures and ways to study them in order to take sub decisions, the next decision. So the relevance of the information analysis, the base begins in the first stage through till the evaluation stage. So what information is required at each stage will be studied as we go along. So let us study the important stage in the planning process. The first is the setting media objective. Why do we think we need to set objectives at all? Because objectives are the guidelines laying out just what is required of the plan. So objectives answer questions of who the advertising needs to reach, where, when, how many, how often, how long, and in what environment. So this media objective will tell you the answer for all these questions, which is called, we call it as setting media objectives. What is the kind of information required? What are the factors which would influence setting media objectives? So by answering these questions, you are essentially in the first stage in the planning process. And there are broadly five elements in a media objective statement. Target audience, the geographic concentration, timing consideration, reach, frequency, creative requirement. So these are the major broadly five elements fixed for media objective statement in a media plan. So let me examine each of the individual element. Target audience, the first target audience, identifying whom the communication is aimed at the very first task. So this is identifying, this is done by identifying the persons who are recognized to be major contributors to the brand. For instance, who is the target audience for motorcycle? The motorcycle would most likely be men in the age group of 18 to 40 years and with a monthly income of minimum rupees, at least rupees 8,000 and above. So this kind of information, so the target audience, this kind of information which is looked at this stage is product usership data in terms of target audience, demographic and psychographic profile. So the target audience is the demographic and psychographic profile, which tells you the reason. So while the first identifies the person and second identifies his lifestyle or interest. So the target audience is whom you're going to communicate the message or about your product. The second, the geographic concentration. So a brand sales pattern would differ from market to market. You see, certain markets are higher in priority because of being large and being large volume markets. And some competitive markets are developmental markets. So media objectives need to specify increased weight planned for such markets. So there is the geography, nothing in the market here, I mentioned. So the information looked for this geographic purpose is the performance of the particular geographical area. Some large volume markets, some will be developmental markets. So according to the geographical concentration, the media objectives has to be set. The third one is the timing consideration. So this factor, the timing factor, relates to the relative importance given to the certain time period of a market seasonality, even at a media event at opportunity. For instance, if a campaign is to launch a low interest items, it would be pertinent to build high initial awareness, thereafter providing continuing support to the key consumption period. So it is a launching item, means you have to have a more in the initial awareness and thereafter not that much pertinent to be given, just to provide the support through the key consumption period. So one of the example is, if any cool drinks or any beverages can take up any event, like media event opportunity, like Lions Cup or any cup, the media event opportunity, and to make its communication, to heighten it, which involved endorsement of the drinking by the particular cricketers. So using that timing, media event opportunity, using that opportunity and launching the product, we can use it. So that is one of the important factor, when to launch. So the timing consideration is one of the important. And the fourth one is the reach frequency. So based on the marketing objective, what is this reach frequency? It is always important to quantify the actual numbers. So there are the physical dimensions of achievement of any plan. The actual number of target person covered is known as reach. And the number of exposures they are to receive is the frequency. So the strategic media planning incorporates setting effective reach or frequency objectives, which are not specifying what portion of the target segment must be reached within the essential minimum frequency. So these things has to be considered. Actual number of target persons is reach, and how often, the number of exposures, which is the frequency, where it has to be an important factor to be considered by fixing of the media objective. And the last one is the creative requirements. The relevant communication characteristics, such as the demonstrability, you see, the creative requirement for any product or any message is, there are different type of communication characteristics are there. So you can sell a product, or you can market a product by using a demonstration. Some toilet cleaners, they used to demonstrate some this washing machine detergents, powders and all, they used to go for a demonstration. Why no? If you demonstrate the product, no, it will become more authoritative, and they believe, people used to believe. Some visualization, humor or fun, in any sense, some visualization characteristics for certain marketing media messages. So visualization in terms of what you say, some acidity or some tablet things. So we have to some drugs, so we have to think of visualization. And for certain thing, sound. So there are various communication characteristics: demonstration, visualization, sound, colors, and creative units. So the creative requirement was one of the important factor before starting up any media plan, while setting up the media objective. So are you clear with the media objectives? The five important elements: target audience, geographic consideration, timing considerations, reach frequency, creative requirements. So these are the important things before starting up any media plan. So the next one is media planning function. So after understanding and doing groundwork of collecting all the five elements and proceeding for a media objective, so to understanding the concept of media planning, let us see how the media planning fits into the overall media agency in developing the campaigns. So client service, you see, it has to go both parallelly with the creative service and media service. So media planning is therefore one of the dual functions of the media department. Both planning and buying are closely linked, later essentially concerned with the execution of the media plan. So in the development of an advertising campaign, both creative department and media department works in close interaction. So this flowchart will show you the client service and the creative department and the media service, planning, buying. And so production, that is the creative department, and the the client service, the media service department, has to work parallelly to influence to the decision taken by the buyer. So media selection is highly invoked task for a marketer. So after planning these things, now the second factor is the media selection. So media selection, how to select media? The major reason for this involvement, that there could be no single best media strategy that would apply to different situations, because the attempts is therefore between media choice and the market preferences. Difference in these approaches will go for a change in the media mixes. So advertisers and marketers in the same industry may be found spending different amount of various media instruments, even though product and markets are the same, because media selection is a Herculean task, because we have a vast number of media, vast number of media to select. So the major consideration here listed out for selection, media selection, the major consideration in media selection are the left side here listed out the various types of media which we discussed in the first slide, and major choice rules for advertising, media coverage, credibility, flexibility, restriction, creativity, and all. So the use selection, media use depends on the both the types of media and the major choice rules by the marketer or the media agency. So in view of this complexity involved in media selection, a managerial framework will help you to make this easy media selection process. In media selection is a complex process, because as the choice of rules are available, n number, and the type of media. So this this process deals with a series of questions that need to be answered in the pursuit of media selection. Just answer for these questions and just go ahead with your media to select. So what kind of consumers does the advertisers wish to reach? So that is the first question. So for selecting a media, there are certain questions which will help you for a best media to select. So although it is expected that the marketing plan would make a specific mention of the target consumers, but it still be given a specific interpretation for a creative media strategy. So the objective of the media strategist here is to define the kind of consumers that the advertising will reach. What kind of consumers does the advertiser wish to reach? So thus attempts it to find out those media that will reach the target consumers exclusively, either exclusively, largely, or which are efficient too. So it's a role of a media strategist to think of what kind of consumer you want to reach. So one option is the consumer demographics, consumer psychographics, and the product usage. This will help you to decide what kind of consumer to use. So it also outlines the area of data requirement for the media choices. The demographics, psychographics, and product usage details, the data will help you to select the target market choice. So the second question is, what kind of message this person is required? After deciding what kind of consumers does the advertisers wish to reach, having all the demographic, psychographic details, the second question, what kind of message this person is required? So the important, this is also the important strategy in media selection. What kind of message this person is, just the message to reach a smaller audience but more frequently, or a bigger audience with less offer. So that is what here they mean it as, the message dispersion. So in normal circumstances, situations, a media selection is based on the consideration that the message should be delivered to many consumers and prospective consumers as possible. So that's what the company used to expect. No, so they want to deliver as many consumers as possible, as many consumers and the prospective consumers as possible. So if a media planner for a toothpaste has to choose between two plants, for example, we are taking an example for a toothpaste, two plants, plant A and plant B, A and B, where plant A consists of 8 primetime television exposures within 4 weeks, delivering one advertising message at least once in 4 weeks to about 70% households. This is plan A. 8 primetime television exposures within 4 weeks. The plan B is 32 afternoon TV exposures at least once in 4 weeks. The choice will be, what will be your choice? The choice A is 8 primetime television exposure within 4 weeks. See, frequently, less of delivering one advertising message at least once in 4 weeks to about 70% of households, or the plan B is 32 afternoon TV exposures at least once in 4 weeks. Obviously, most of the choice will be plan A. How frequently and less often you decide. Okay, what sort of dispersion you want for your advertising message? 8 primetime television exposure or 32 afternoon TV exposure? Obviously, you will choose plan A, the primetime 8 exposures, not the afternoon TV exposures 32 times. So, the name of the game is the number of the people reached. However, many research evidence bring a note of caution in the above selection, because we are not every day they are doing research. This evidence suggests exposure is usually ineffective. The central goal of media selection should be place emphasis on enhancing the frequency of exposure rather than reach. So this is one important point that they have come out with the research. The media selection has to place emphasis on enhancing the frequency of exposure rather than reach. So it is believed because the prime time will help you for more reachability, and the afternoon TV exposure will help you for more frequency of exposure. So it is believed that exposure frequency of 2 within a purchase cycle is quite effective, while increasing the frequency beyond 3 exposures, even though spread out for 4 or even 8 weeks, no, it won't be effective, but a decreasing rate. So there is some studies are there which they are working on this media media frequency. The issue gets further complicated with the introduction of message dispersion advertiser. It is not a matter how much we reach, it is a matter of how the giving emphasis to how many times, how much frequency of exposure. So many media strategies support the pulsing or waving pattern of message release on the ground of cost efficiency. So it strengthens the threshold level of our advertisement. So the frequency, so as you see, the prime time or the frequency of or how frequent or how less often. Okay, usually the frequency of exposure will work out more. Some research is suggesting. The third question is, what kind of seasonal and regional concentration is required for advertising? The task of media selection is conditioned by the element of seasonal or regional variation in the media intensity. So it is especially important for those products and services that have seasonal or regional demand. For example, seasonal products, ice creams, soft drinks, air conditions, ceiling fans, and some festive demands for pujas and Christmas, and some even for some textile items for festive demands. So the seasonal regional concentration is one of the important factor to be considered and answer for a proper best media selection. Subcultures like the lifestyles depends on the seasonal selection. So setting the media in this mode of seasonal concentration is usually easier than the regional concentration. So seasonal and regional demands has to be taken care while selecting a media. And the fourth question is, what attributes should be inherent in a selected media? What attributes? So here they are going for a media must add value to the marketing messages. So this is most important attribute that is inherent in a good media. So the value is both qualitative and quantitative. Quantitative means the media having their own weight to the messages. For example, a particular newspaper is known for its fair editorial content and fair news. No, then the judicial selection of advertisement will appear in just such a newspaper will carry an additional effect. It's given an added effect for the advertising message. The second one is the other option is media is highly, some media is highly inexpensive but can deliver the message only at a broad scale. So here media adds, the attribution or the quality of the media adds value to the products. There are ways in media strategies find solution for this. Accepting, so the attributes of the media will also place an important role in selecting the media. So by summarizing the selection pattern of answering the questions, what kind of consumer do you want? Psychographic, demographic and characteristics. What kind of message dispersion? The frequency of exposure. What kind of seasonal or regional concentration? Seasonal demands and festival demands. I have mentioned some few examples of products. And what attributes, the media attributes. So by having value of the media will add value to our products. So these are the questions to be considered before selecting a media. Next is the media scheduling. After planning, setting media objectives and doing research work, groundwork, and coming to the selection of media, even selection of media answering for many questions, coming to media scheduling, once the media planning and selection is completed to the satisfaction of both the advertisers and the media agencies, now the attention is diverted to the task of deciding the media scheduling. So it concerns answering such questions as how many of each media vehicle space and time units be bought. This scheduling is not just scheduling your message, media message. Over what and time units this will be bought, and over what period should such buying be. So do we want a steady schedule or do we want a pulsed campaign? So concentrating heavily in the beginning and later slowing down. So yes, we want a steady schedule or a pulsed campaign, concentrating in the beginning and later slowing down. So normally media scheduling is considered of a 4-week period in any instance. Thus an advertiser, the following 6 types of schedules are available for scheduling a media plan. There are 6 types of schedules are available. Steady pulse is the easiest types of schedules to prepare. For example, 1 ad per week for 52 weeks or 1 ad per month for 12 months. The preparation like scheduling for this set of media is a steady pulse. Okay, the steady is weekly, monthly ads, 52 weeks or 12 months, just prepare and schedule it. The second one is seasonal pulse. The seasonal nature of products dictate the use of seasonal pulse. As I said, no ice cream, air condition. So the nature of the seasonal nature of the products will dictate the use of seasonal pulse. Example, cold cream, ceiling fans, air conditioners. So this will help in the month of winter and summer respectively. So cold creams will be in the season, winter season, and the ceiling fans and air conditioner will be in the summer season. So that is what the seasonal pulse. To schedule media, so this is where you are going, the products will decide you take up which type of scheduling you want to do. Period pulse. Scheduling of media at regular intervals but not related to the seasons of the year. It is called the periodic pulse. So for example, as I mentioned in the media selection, no, when you are selecting the media, concentration on season. Okay, here the period pulse is, it is not like putting the media in a regular interval period. So the periodic pulse is media scheduling for consumer durables like festival demands and puja, some food items, processed foods for Christmas festivals or for gifting purpose, so for particular seasons. So the period pulse. And the fourth one is erratic pulse. So when advertising is based at irregular intervals, it is called as erratic pulse. What is this erratic pulse? It's by itself, it's not to be ignored. It's quite likely the advertiser is trying to cause changes in the typical purchase cycles, just trying out ceiling fans and soft drinks during winter. Just so erratic pulse. Advertising in the months other than the summer months could attempt to even out purchase throughout the year. Just an attempt of just changing the typical purchase cycles. The fifth one is the startup pulse. And it is quite common to see a heavily concentrated media selling to open either a new product or a new campaign. So this is what they call it as startup pulse. For instance, scheduling launching a new brand, a new model, no, so startup pulse, where you have to concentrate, heavily concentrated, and the frequency of exposure. You see, when we selected media selection, the frequency exposure will be more for this startup pulse scheduling, the promotional pulse. So this scheduling pattern suits only a particular promotion team of the company. For example, For example, if you take a nature of one time only, advertising will be heavily concentrated during a particular time. For example, promoting what is the eco-friendly. So several companies they used to launch their vehicle for that particular 10th anniversary, they will be launching that particular vehicle. So it will be concentrated during a particular time only. So that is used for the promotion of that particular event. So that is, even though several scheduling patterns are available with their unique characteristics, it is remembering that scheduling is a part of a media strategy. You decide which sort of which types of scheduling pulse you require for your media. So a regular review of the scheduling pattern is beneficial to the advertisers. So with this media scheduling, we'll discuss about the analysis, reach, frequency and continuity. So several research, so that's why this market research and media product research, you know, has been done frequently around the clock, around the year they will be doing to verify and keep on frequently changing their media selection and the media scheduling. So researchers have been conducted on analyzing the data to reach, frequency and continuity. So some of the major findings are listed below, which are found by the media planners, would tell us to remember: continuity assumes importance because advertising is often forgotten if not reinforced by continual exposure. It would thus be unwise for a marketer to spend money 1 week on running an advertisement which is to be followed by another, let's say, after 6 months only. Such long gap will fail to reinforce the message. So continuity is an important factor, because once if it is forgotten, it is again very difficult to reinforce for the continual exposure. The repeated exposure. So these are some of the research findings where the media planners suggesting us to taking for consideration in reach, frequency and continuity. The repeated exposures are needed to impress a message on the memories of a large product proportion of consumers. So the frequency. How more frequency of exposure will make us to memorize the large proportion. As number of exposures increases, the number of persons who remember it will get increased. So not only this length of time, which they remember also increases. Remembering is a key thing to media planners. Now, how many have visited the shop is more important than how much turnover, because one day they will come. So how much they remember. So remembering is a key thing for any media planner. And an intensive burst of advertising is more likely to cause a large number of people to remember it. So at least for a short time than spreading the campaign uniformly. In many cases, reaching as many people as possible may be as important the task of reaching fewer number of people but more frequently. That's why this media planning and media scheduling and media selecting and media selection and media scheduling often used to be reviewed frequently according to the trend and according to the pulse of the audience or the viewers or the readers. So that's why any media agency or any media department, they used to work round the clock. If they are fixing a media selection or media schedule for a particular product, the job is not over. It has to be continued throughout the year, and they have to change the strategy. And as a media planner or media strategist, you have to change the pattern very often. Okay, so it goes with the emphasizing the media planning is more an art than a science, because many credible and applied scientific methods have been evolved from this media planning. So it tests the knowledge, perception and skills of any media planner. So in any media management, the role of media planner and media strategist is very important. So as I said, once a product is launched or once a product advertisement is message is done, the job of the media scheduling and selection is not over. You have to frequently change on working on reviewing it and taking suggestion from the market research and taking suggestion from the creative media department, and you have to keep on changing and you have to present. So now I'll summarize the class. So media planning is a decision-making process aimed to arrive at three basic decisions. What should be the media objective? which media should be selected, how are the selected media to be used. A media plan evolves from and fully integrated with the marketing, advertising or creative objectives. Evaluating media opportunities is to explore which media are available and what role they could play in the coverage of the target audience. Developing a media strategy entails the describing how precisely the selected media mix would be used in relation to each other with a view to achieve the set media objectives. So media planning and media evaluation is a crucial and important stage to check whether the planned media programs conforms to the objectives, and the evaluation is necessarily qualitative and reach and frequency levels and fine tune if need. Before the plan is implemented, we can review and we can change it. This is the media economics. The unit 2 of your media management syllabus is media economics. So in that, today's session is media structure, features of media economics, types of market systems, and media market. These are all the topics that we are going to cover today. So in media economics, what is the role of economics in media? Yes, as we have seen in the last class, media has become a business. When it has become a business, it has entered into the market. When it has entered into the market, when the concept of mass manufacturing comes in, when it becomes the mass manufacturing or mass production thing, because of reaching to many people, invading, exploring into the new lands and new routes. Okay, now I am tracing back the history of the marketing and the business, how it has come. Okay, so likewise, it has become a business and it has become a market. So if these market and business involves economics and media is now being an business entity, the media also involved with some economics.
what we are going to see in our media management module paper is basic ideas and basic concepts in media economics. In that, the first topic for today is media structure, different media, how media is structurized. As you all know, print media, electronic media, and what are the different features of media economics? Economics involved in many fields, and when it comes to media, what are the features or distinctive features? And types of market systems. What are the different types of, when it becomes a market, then we have to compare the media with the market and different types of market system and what is media market. So this class will be an introductory session for all these topics that I have mentioned here. After completion of the session, you learn about media structure and its various economic scenarios and the distinctive features of media economics, various types of market systems, and what is media market? Just an idea. Topic of today, media economics and media as a structure and system. So this particular topic provides an overview of the main features of media economics and the typical system of regulation. Regulation is, that is in the part of governance, how it can be governed in terms of economic governance. Okay, there are some governance, it's related to the policy, it's related to the broadcasting and all. Here what we are going to see is the governance. Media economics and system of regulation show distinctive features, and this is not the case for any enterprises or organization or institution. As I said, economics involved in many organizations or many entities or many institutions, and that is not the case for media, because media has its own distinctive features in economics. That's why we have to see what are those distinctive features related to media and system of regulation, that is governance, which is compared with the other industry sectors and other institutional areas. Why this is distinct from other organization or other institute? What is the difference? The key to the differences in both the cases, even in governance as well as in economics, is the key difference is the dual character of media. What is the dual character of media? Media being both a commercial enterprise and a key element in the political, cultural and social life to society. So there is a dual character of media. It's a commercial enterprise. As an organization, as an institution, as a firm, it is a commercial enterprise. And the other character, other side of character of media is, it's a main, one of the main element in the political, cultural and social life of the society. They cannot be left entirely to the marketplace or closely be regulated. So that's why the governance comes, because we cannot leave this media entire to the marketplace for such other organizations, or we can't closely regulate because of its nature, that is dual character, commercial as well as social entity. So neither media forms nor governments have a free hand to imply the policy. Mass media can be regulated in marginal or indirect ways by governments. It cannot be closely regulated a medium. It can be regulated in marginal or indirect ways only by the government, as what we have seen in the television production, various committees and various policies developed by different governments and various committees appointed by the government has recommended their the policy guidelines in terms of operating. So for regulating the media, now I want to just recall one of the one of the thing that we discussed in that television production mass media policy is, after emergency Indira Gandhi came to the power, she felt that there should be some sort of regulation or control over the media, then media, television and radio, to imbalance the elements or message created by the free press. So the governments has recommended, appointed various committees to regulate. So what he are telling is mass media can be regulated in marginal or indirect ways by governments, just a recall of various committees and various policies developed by the government. The forms of governance are extremely varied. Here governance means regulation. So internal governance and external governance, informal and as well as formal, and different forms of regulations are applied to different technologies of distribution. Now we are in, as we are in the different forms of technologies are available for distribution channel. So the forms of governments are rooted in the history and political cultures of each society. So that's why every now and then the committees have been appointed, and there are various amendments and changes in the regulation because of the history and political culture and the different technologies that are involved in distribution of this mass media. Our concentration and the core concentration for this session and for this class is the economic concept in media, economic principles of media structure. What are the different economic principles of media structure? Different media markets and source of income. So according to Robert George Pickard, who is an American writer and scholar, is one of the leading experts on media businesses and media policy economics, and he is considered as the father of media economic studies. He has taught at both Harvard University and University of Oxford. This is a brief bio of Robert George Pickard. According to him, a market consists of sellers that provide the same good or service or closely suitable goods or services to the same group of consumers. That is what, according to Robert George Pickard, a market consists of sellers that provide the same good or services or closely suitable goods or services to the same group of consumers, according to Robert George Pickard. In general, if you want to define what is a market in general, markets can be defined according to place, people, type of revenue, and the nature of the product or service. Have you got this idea of a definition for market? Yeah. According to, markets can be defined according to the place, people, type of revenue, and the nature of the product or service, where you have to go back and see the history of marketing is just the distribution channel. When this distribution channel came is after the land, attaining, exploring into your new land, venturing into your new people needs and the customer needs. So the market can be defined by the place where you're going to sell your product, the people whom you're going to sell, and the type of revenue and the nature of the product or service. We can define market. And a more fundamental line of economic division in the media business is between the consumer market for media products and services and the advertising market, in which a service is sold to advertisers. As I said, no, this is also one of the dual functioning of a media market. You see, any media market, when you take it for economic division, media business is between two things. What? The consumer market, the customers, or the viewers, or the readers, or the listeners. So the media business is between the consumers, that is viewers, readers, or listeners, for the media products. Product is the television programs, radio programs, and newspapers, news articles, news stories. And what is the next one? The services and the advertising market, where the services, the advertising service is sold to the advertisers in the form of access to the audience. As you if you remember, marketing media is not only meant for marketing. That's what we have discussed in the last class. Media is meant for not only marketing. It has its own language, and it has its own agenda or functions to perform with the society, with the target audience. Information, entertainment, everything in that, marketing and advertising is a part of media. So the second, the economic division in media is the advertising market, where in which a service is sold to advertising in the form of access to the audience. So to put it in a simple term, two things for a media: consumer market for media products and services, and the advertising market, which is service to sold the advertisers in the form of access to the audience. As I said, no, to define media as a business, you have to see it in a two perspective. One is the advertiser's perspective, and the other one is the target audience perspective. So this feature of media economics, if reliance on two different source of revenue. There are two different source of revenue for any media. One is from the consumer, the viewers, if it is television, readers, and the other source of revenue is from the advertisers. So the features of media economics reliance on these two different sources. One can note, within the consumer market, there is another division. If you take a consumer market, the market is between the one-off product. They used to say it's one-off product, like books, tapes, videos, and newspapers, which is sold directly to consumers. Newspapers sold to consumers, and that for continuous media like cable. Okay, I want to mention here is the one-off product: book, tape, video, and newspaper. Why they are known as a one-off product? No, one-time selling product. It is not like the internet, new medium, or the television broadcasting. So videotapes or videos, books are the one-off product. In fact, there are other source of incomes besides these two mentioned. Okay, other source of income for media. What are the other source of income? It includes sponsorship, product placement, and public relation activities also. So this is the main concept of the economic principles of media structure being a dual. It's not like it's a dual medium to serve both the content to the, as Ramakrishna mentioned, the content to the audience, and the, what you say, the functions to the advertisers who want to do. And this second feature for a principle of media structure is advertising versus consumer revenue. The difference between the two main source of revenue is direct product sales and advertising. It's an important tool for comparative analysis and for explaining the media features and trends. The distinction between these media types, some media are rather unsuitable for advertising. So as I mentioned, that one-off media, videotapes, books, I said it as one-off media. No, they are, sometimes it won't be suitable for, unsuitable for advertising, while others can operate in the markets like television, radio, newspapers, magazines, and internet. There are some advertising revenue only media with no consumer revenue. For instance, you heard about some free newspapers, promotional magazines, and there are few television channels which are open, free channels. Those channels are considered to be the advertising revenue only media. So those channels run only on the advertisers, advertising revenue, and with not the consumer revenue. As I mentioned, free newspapers, magazine, promotional magazines, and few television channels are there. Advertising based media are accessed according to the number and type of consumers. I said, no, advertising based media are accessed according to the number and type of consumers, who they are, where they live, reached by particular messages, circulation, readership, and reach our ratings. Okay, when we are concluding at the end of this session, no, you will be knowing the answer for these questions, will give you the definition for marketing and as well as media marketing, who they are, where they live. So, occur, it's the media, advertising based media are accessed according to the number and type of consumers. The market performance of media content that is paid for directly by consumers is assessed by the income received from the sales and subscription to services. So that is the other aspect of media, the consumer revenue. So advertising versus the consumer revenue, these two things are the implications in media market. Ratings of satisfaction and popularity may be relevant to both markets, but they won't count for relatively more in the consumer income in the market. It is not like the channel which is having more subscribers or more viewers will give, end up with the result to give more advertising. So that is one of the implication where you have to look into the advertising versus the consumer revenue in media market. Performance in one market can affect the performance in another where a medium operates in both. For instance, an increase in newspaper sales that is producing more consumer revenue can lead to higher advertising rates, provided that increase does not lead to lower than average level of the socioeconomic composition by the population, with a reverse effect on an unit advertising rates. What they're trying to tell is, increase in newspaper sales will increase higher advertising rates, as the, for television, depending on the DRP they are calculating, and for newspapers, the readership. It is also clear that difference of revenue base can lead to different kinds of opportunity and also vulnerability to wider economic circumstances. So that is why it is very important to look into this media economics in a media organization. Media that are highly dependent on advertising are likely to be more sensitive to the negative impact of general economic downturns than media that sell. So for usually the low-cost products selling to the individual consumers, different media markets and source of income for media, and the implications in the advertising and consumer revenue. So these things are important to note down for media in an economics perspective, or if you want to see the functions of economics in media. Going to next, the distinctive features of media economics. So let's just understand some typical features of economics of media, which distinguishes them from other kinds of business. So what are the distinctive features of economics of media, which distinguishes from the other kinds of business? First, we have to understand media are typically hybrid or mixed in character. It operate in a dual market. What is the dual market? Selling a product to consumers and a service to advertisers. It's a dual market. So this is one of the distinctive features of media economics. It has to sell the product to consumers and service to advertisers. So this is the dual character of a media market. They are extremely diversified in terms of the type of product they sold and the range of technologies and organizational means of distribution. The type of product is for the consumers, that is the viewers or readers, users, and the technology and organizational means for distribution is for service to the advertisers. Secondly, media cost structures. The media cost structures are characterized by high labor incentives and high fixed costs. although both dependencies are diminishing as a result of technological change and media expansion. Because of media expansion and technological change or technological development, these things are changing. So media cost structures are characterized by high fixed costs. And the third feature is high degree of uncertainty, which refers, and also the uniqueness of the product, which the high degree of uncertainty refers to the consumer evaluation. What do you mention? The consumer evaluation, because it is still difficult to predict audience taste for music, films or books. However, much manipulation through publicity is tried. That's where the scope of market research comes in, because one of the feature of media is it has a high degree of uncertainty, and that is, it is very difficult to predict the audience taste for music, films. Before, before Corona, the viewing or media using habits was totally different. So it is difficult to predict audience taste for media usage. What you have mentioned is the music, films or books. It's very difficult to know the taste of people. So here comes the scope of doing market research, knowing the two things to do market research. One is to know the effectiveness or the impact of the message or the advertising that you broadcasted on the your media. That is one aspect of knowing with market research. The other thing is to know the pulse of the audience or the customer or consumer, and what they expect, not only from the product and the message from media. So the next feature is standardization. Many media products can be easily differentiated on a day-to-day basis and can rarely be repeatedly sold in exactly same form. Standardization is one of the important feature which works in a media product, because media organization and the product has a unique feature of having the creative characteristics. We can standardize the media products, which can be easily differentiated on a day-to-day basis, basing on receiving the pulse or the audience or viewers' perspective. Next feature is media seem has a tendency of concentration. So this is one of the important feature for media when compared to any other business. This may happen because of the advantages of monopoly control of advertising markets are so evident. And the next media feature is hard to enter without large capital resources. This is also one of the important feature of media economics. It's very hard to enter without large capital resources. Many media businesses, at least those involving distribution, are unusually have to face this stage, mainly because of high fixed cost and high launch cost for any media. One cannot hope to start up a significant newspaper or a television channel in a small way. It is not possible. Although there are niche markets are available, as you can see, the regional newspapers. If you want to launch up a new product or a new newspaper or a new television channel, you can't start it in a small way. Media are differently simply because they are affected by public interest. This is not the case for any other business or any other business product. So thus, they are not just any other business, tend to be burdened with a considerable responsibility, because it's affected by public interest. While the production and manufacturing oriented business focuses on production and tries to sell products, but media, it's affected by the public interest. The customer-oriented business focus on the need of the customer and produces accordingly by only aware of the marketability of the services or the products sold. So these are the features, what we can say, the distinctive features of media economics, which is not just like in any other business. Media are hybrid in respect of markets, product and technology. Media have high fixed costs. It involves creativity and uncertainty. As I said, no, the standardization, it involves creativity and uncertainty. Uncertainty is one of the features. Products can be multiple used and recycled. The media products can be multiply used. Media tend naturally to concentration. Media business is difficult to enter because of high fixed cost and high launch costs. Media are not just any other business because of the public interest aspects. Like any other business, a manufacturing business focus on the production and selling. Customer service business focus on service oriented aspects. But media is not like that. So because it is affected by the public interest, so this is one of the distinctive feature to be considered for media. So for what we have seen is the role of economics in media and media market. Now we will move to the next types of market system. Before entering into media market, we will see the general market systems. In market economies, there are variety of different market systems that exist depending on the industry and the companies within that industry. So the five major market system types are listed out here: perfect competition, monopoly, oligopoly, monopolistic competition, and monopsony. So there's a five major market system types. So let me see one by one. Perfect competition with infinite buyers and sellers. Perfect competition is a market system characterized by many different buyers and sellers. The classical theoretical definition for this perfect competition is there are an infinite number of buyers and sellers. With so many market players, it is impossible for any one participant from buyer or seller to alter the prevailing price in the market. If they attempt to do so, buyers and sellers have infinite alternatives to pursue. So this is the perfect competition market. Infinite buyers and infinite sellers. No, a single participant from a buyer or the seller's side can alter the prevailing price in the market, because if they try to do so, they have, the buyers also have the alternatives to pursue, that is for the sellers, and even the sellers have infinite alternatives to pursue. If a buyer wants to change some price, prevailing price in the market, the sellers have the infinite options to pursue, because there are infinite buyers playing in the market. And if a sellers want to change their product or change their line, buyers have the alternative way to reach the sellers. So that is what they call it as the perfect competition market with infinite buyers and sellers. And the second one is the monopoly. Only one producer with one producer. A monopoly is the exact opposite form of market system as perfect competition. In a pure monopoly, there is only one producer of a particular good or service, and generally no regional substitute. So what will happen in such a market system? The monopolist is able to charge whatever price they wish due to the absence of competition. But their overall revenue will be limited by the ability of willingness of customers to pay their price. So even though the monopoly is the only single player in the market who produce a particular good or service, they can't exceed their or increase their revenue price, or they can't exceed the overall revenue because of the limitation by the factor to be considered by the ability of willingness of customers to pay their price. So considering the willingness of the customers paying the price, they can't exceed their revenue. The next one is the oligopoly. An oligopoly is similar in many ways to a monopoly. The primary difference is, rather than having only one producer of a goods or service, there are handful of producers, or at least a handful of producers that make up a dominant majority of the production in the market system. So these oligopolies do not have the same pricing power as monopolies. It is possible without diligent government regulations that oligopolies will collude with one another to set prices in the same way a monopolist would. It's a monopoly, the same for a same particular product or service, there will be only one player or one producer. Here in oligopoly, for a particular product or particular service, there will be handful of producers. That is the only difference between monopoly and oligopoly. Next is the monopolistic competition with numerous competitors. Monopolistic competition is a type of a market system combining elements of a monopoly and perfect competition. Like a perfectly competitive market system, there are numerous competitors in the market. The difference is that each competitor is sufficiently differentiated from others. So the monopolistic is, as I said, the combination of the elements from monopoly and perfect competition. But the difference is how it is differentiated from the others, that some can charge greater prices than a perfectly competitive firm. If you want to know the example for a monopolistic competition is, while there are many artists, so monopoly, single producer, and a perfect competition, infinite buyers and sell. While there are many artists, each artist is different and is not perfectly substitutable with another artist. So the next one, the last one, the last type of market system is monopsony. So only one buyer. Market systems are not differentiated according to the number of suppliers in the market. They may also be differentiated according to the number of buyers. Whereas perfectly competitive market has an infinite number of buyers and sellers, monopsony has only one buyer for a particular good or service, giving that buyer significant power in determining the price of the products produced. Here, the buyer has the significant role in determining the price of product produced. So this is general introduction for different types of general market systems prevailing in the business. So next, with this, next we will see media. We will see what is media market. So general market system, what we have seen is the perfect competition, monopoly, monopsony, monopolistic, monopsony, oligopoly, monopoly, and perfect competition. Now we will get into our business, is the media market. How this media market can be categorized by the area of dominant influence. And what do you mean by media market? An area or group of people where everyone receives the same message from the television programs or reads the same newspaper. A media market describes the group of consumers that have access to the same marketing messages. Group of consumers that have access to the same marketing messages. Typically, media markets relate to radio, television, print medium, newspapers, magazines, online newspapers. And since now the internet plays a vital role in the marketing today, so internet media market is also another medium to be considered for delivering what we have mentioned here. The radio, television, print, newspaper and magazine has been delivered in the internet medium, internet platform. So internet media market is also one of the another medium to be considered. Broadcast market, medium, region, market area. The primary factor in establishing a market is location or geography. So before, if you want to describe a media market, the first factor, the primary first and foremost factor to be considered is location or geography. A media region typically consists of areas that are close in proximity to each other. This means market does not consist of different states or regions, one on the south, one on the north, one on the east, one on the west. If you take newspapers, state wise. If you take television channel, mostly state wise. And if you take it in regional wise, south, north, east and west. In short, media region consists of the areas that the media publication reaches, which typically means two or three states that run into each other. A market typically overlaps with at least one major state. If you take, for example, newspapers in North India, if you take it in the location or geography wise, some newspapers have a coverage. I'm speaking about the regional newspapers, local regional newspapers. It overlaps with the other state. So media region information is used by the media outlets to sell advertising spots. Most media markets include two or three states or region, like south, east, west, north. For example, in a country like ours, few of the northern states make up one media market. When comparing television media markets with radio markets, there is a noticeable size difference is there, because the television market is big when compared to the radio market, because television market tends to consist a much larger area than a radio market. Because of this is because of reach of radio station tends to be smaller than that of a television station. So that's why media region information is used by the media outlets to sell their advertising spot. So when it comes to the second character or the distinct feature of a media business is to use as a service business for advertisers, this media market plays a major role, and the media region is plays a major role, which is used by the media outlets to sell their advertising spots. For example, how this media region is identified and how it has been charged and how the cost has been fixed and all has been done by the market research. For example, Nielsen Media Research and many market research organizations are there, market research, which tracks the viewing behavior of individual households that fall within each media market. So that is, as I said, no, before, the scope of market research companies, market research firms, which tracks the viewing behavior of individual households. This will give you the input for defining and describing the media region and the media market, which will be more helpful for any media enterprise to fix and sell their advertising spots. So what they are going to track, these market research companies, they're tracking the information, the data collecting, which includes demographics, such as our age of the individuals, in the household, income levels, education levels, and other information about the consumers of the media. So the advertisers can use this information to identify whether or that not the media outlet is appropriate for its product or services. So the market media region will tells you the advertisers to take up this media outlet for their selling, for their as their medium. For example, if a company sells cosmetics for teens, it will review the information about the people and households that are in the media market to see if their target market exists within that media region. That is why this is important. So defining the media market is very important, and the primary factor is from the location and to the media region, which tells you the demographic and all the information that required for any media market. Got some idea about the media structure and the importance of a role of economics in media and the features of media economics and why it is different from other businesses and the market system types, and just an introduction, brief idea about the media market.